We return tonight to a regular Monday feature focusing on issues that are of concern to those watching the state legislature. Two political types go one-on-one. Tonight, House Republican spokesman Barrett Marson goes head-to-head with John Loredo, a former Democratic legislator and political consultant with Tequida and Gutierrez.
We've never seen these types of crowds come out for political events before. Never. I've never seen anything like this. Massive crowds, a lot of young people coming to the ballot, and I think the war is a huge issue for young people. It's going to drive them out stronger than we've seen since the Vietnam War.
You know, while the Democrats are coming here, they're campaigning, the state has been bereft of almost any campaign event for a Republican. It appears really the Republicans have conceded this state to John McCain. There's dissatisfaction among some conservatives. Apparently John McCain, pro-life, anti-gay marriage, and pro-national security, a very strong advocate of national security, and a great war hero, isn't conservative enough. And I don't really understand that all the time. There's a couple of bills that he sponsored, some of them have become law, that conservatives aren't all that happy with. But it has really taken them, and there's great anger with him among those people. Even though he still gets 80s and 90s among many conservative groups, he's very much pro-Second Amendment and very much pro-life. So it's hard to understand sometimes why some conservatives are that much against John McCain, but Mitt Romney is not able to capitalize on that here, neither is Huckabee or any other candidate. Sure. They have pretty much left the state to John McCain.
Well, and it appears, I mean, that he has made he's the comeback kid of the year. I mean, mm-hmm. he started out strong, kind of took a dip when the other candidates started jumping in. Thompson was supposed to, make a big hit. He just fizzled out before he even started. And now back to McCain. So it is really interesting that you always hear about how he's not conservative enough, but he seems to be doing pretty good all over the country.
Right, and those core fiscal issues. There is nobody more stellar on those core fiscal issues than McCain. He votes against budgets because they have too much pork in it. He's doesn't take earmarks, and those are hallmarks of a good conservative. And yet, some people still aren't happy with him. But while everyone else is conceding Arizona, just today he was in Boston. Sure. Mitt Romney's home turf, and he was campaigning pretty hard there. So he is challenging Mitt Romney. He's trying to show that he'll run a national campaign.
Well, and he's got a good shot at really taking a huge lead tomorrow on Super Tuesday, so much so that it'll be pretty much impossible for anyone to mount a legitimate comeback after if he takes a substantial amount of the vote.
You know, one thing about tomorrow, and we have delegates, both each of the parties has their own delegates, and so they have, to a certain extent, their own rules. But one thing state law says is that the delegates, when they go to the convention, must vote for the candidate that best represents the will of the voters. But it doesn't mean that they have to actually vote for the person who won. So if McCain wins tomorrow, it's a great victory. It doesn't mean all of the delegates have to then go to the convention and support McCain. I believe back in 96 it was, when one person cast a vote for Phil Graham.
Sure.
And so it's a little different that way.
And I think on the Democratic side, you have a race that could very well run into March. Mm-hmm. And if that happens, I would imagine that sometime after tomorrow, you'll start seeing John Edwards come out and endorse. You'll see Bill Richardson come out and endorse. I think that the reality of a convention at which the nominee is actually picked there, it's just not something that people really want to have happen. So I think you'll probably see a lot of endorsements come through and hopefully swing it one way or the other.
You know, one of the bigger surprises to me in this whole presidential election has been the amount of money that Ron Paul has received. In the last quarter, he received $20 million. I don't know who these people are who are giving to Ron Paul, but I wish they'd come to Arizona and help us solve our budget crisis, because clearly they got money to spend any which way they want. And Arizona could really use that money right now. We're about $1 billion in the hole just for the current fiscal year, maybe about $1.7 billion if we don't do much this year for the next fiscal year. And, unfortunately, there isn't a grand desire from the executive or from the Democrats to fix the problem. There's a desire to delay the problem.
Well, but I think, the governor already has her budget proposal out there. I mean, she's already got a plan to fix the budget crisis, and and the Republicans, I mean, it appears, you know, you've got kind of blow-ups in committees. You've got Russell Pierce is going to unveil his master plan that'll fall flat on the ground, and then behind the scenes, leaders are doing something else.
That's all inside. I think what you're really seeing from the governor's budget is beg, borrow, steal. You know, you're borrowing money to build schools. It's, you know, and it's not like buying a home. I get tired of hearing it's like buying a home. Well, nobody in Arizona buys a home every single year. And school construction is something we will do for the foreseeable future. As long as people come to Arizona, we'll be borrowing for schools. At some point, it'll cost more to pay the debt service on these schools than it will to actually build the schools.
But
and that's a problem.
Right now is the perfect time to revenue bond. This is the time when you should be revenue bonding because the rates are so very low. I mean, they haven't been this low in decades. So right now is the time. And one more thing. If you simply do what Russell Pierce wants to do and do a moratorium on school construction, that's not addressing the problem. That really is putting it off till next time. But if you revenue bonded and you build those schools, you're pumping money into the economy. Those schools have to get built by somebody. Those are jobs, contractors, subcontractors. Now is the perfect time to borrow at very low rates and put money into the economy to kickstart.
The problem is for most Democrats, that desire to bond never ends. Even when the state was flush with cash, the governor still proposed bonding to spend that money in other areas.
Well, and the Republicans came up with the brilliant idea of lease purchasing mobile homes to teach kids in, and that was a ridiculous idea. So you know, I mean, you either keep up with growth and build permanent schools for those kids to go, or you just put it off, and that's the Republican plan, is just to turn your back on it and ignore it.
But, you know, part of the problem with the Democrat plan is, or the governor's plan, you know, the beg, borrow, steal. I mean, it's pretty much smile, you're on Janet cam. And, you know, she wants to put about 100 cameras on our state highways. You know how many drivers have to get tickets to reach her $90 million revenue number? 4 million drivers. That's one ticket for every single licensed driver. And if you don't get a ticket, John, because I know you obey our traffic laws, then somebody else has to get two.
Well, but only if they break the law.
There's an easy solution here. Don't break the law.
Law.
You know what the problem with that is? If they don't break the law, then the state can't balance its budget. The state should not be relying on the speed cameras. The state should not be relying on speed cameras to balance our budget. And that's
exactly
the problem.
Why we should revenue bond for school construction at the lowest rate in modern history.
But the governor wants to do both. It has to do both.
Looking at the photo camera issue as a budget issue, then we can go back and forth. But the reality is this. I mean, a study came out last week or the week before about the cameras on the loop. They have directly led to lower speeding. Less accidents and more lives saved on that loop. So from a public safety standpoint, it's pretty hard to argue against because it is effective.
John, I will gladly give you that point that they bring speeds down, but we shouldn't be using them as a way to balance the state budget. And that's the problem.
Which is why we should revenue bond.